Welcome to this beautiful lesson in which we'll be taking a look at the last law which was put forward by Gregor Mendel. Yes, we'll be talking about the law of independent assortment. Yes, we'll be talking about the law of independent assortment. Now, this law, as we know, is based on the dihybrid ratio. Yes, that means two characters at the time. Let's study this law with the help of an example of dihybrid ratio. But before that, let us think about what kind of statement or what type of explanation this law has to say us. Well, basically, for us, now that we have seen the law of dominance, the law of segregation, yes, you may wonder, we all know these things, right? We know there is a process called meiosis. So, we also know that the gametes will be formed having one chromosome each. That means the number of chromosomes gets divided. Then we also get to know that the chromosomes divide in such a way, they come to each allele or they come to each different gamete in such a way that there is proper rearrangement. We know chiasma formation. We also know synapses and all these kind of processes, right? So, what is new in this? Why are we studying this all together as a new concept? Well, let me tell you, this all is known to us today. Yes, today in this century. But all these things of genetics, all these things related to molecular biology and all, these were not known to people late back in the 17th century. Yes, when even people did not know what is genetics, Gregor Mendel tried performing experiments and he put forward these hypotheses. So, that means based on his hypothesis, we tried studying the genetics part. So, now that you and me know what is meiosis, how rearrangements takes place and everything, yes, it was not known to Gregor Mendel at that time. And that's the reason why he put forward these laws. Yes, so looking at these laws, studying these laws needs us to go back in the 17th century and learn them as if we don't know anything. So, for now, when we study, now that we know law of dominance also, law of segregation also, now when we study law of independent assortment, we need to, for a moment, forget the fact that there is something called synapses, crossing over and rearrangement in case of chromosomes. We absolutely don't know these things. We don't know what is the process of meiosis, and then we study the law of independent assortment. Yes, this is how we need to study each and everything in genetics right from scratch, right since the beginning, as if we don't know anything that is known to us today. Yes, so let's see what Gregor Mendel had to say in this law of independent assortment, the last law based on dihybrid ratio. In this, as the name says, law of independent assortment. What are we assorting? Assorting is segregating or separating independently. Yes, the alleles are going to the gametes independent of each other. Yes, so this law stated that basically, when in an individual, yes, the alleles remain with each other, correct? They are always together in a diploid organism. During the spore formation, they go randomly independent of each other. Yes, they get separated from each other irrespective of other going towards gametes. Now, when the time of fertilization comes, that is the time of offsprings being born, that time they will rearrange themselves again in an independent way such that new combinations as well as parental combinations are conserved. Yes, new combinations are formed and parental combinations are conserved. So, what exactly is this law trying to say us? It is trying to say us that the alleles in a pair get separated or get segregated, to be precise, independent of each other, correct, during the process of, yes, gamete or spore formation. So, during the process of gamete or spore formation. This is what we have known till now. Now, moving ahead further than this, when we say that alleles in a pair get segregated independent of each other during the process of gamete or spore formation, yes, and further, and they rearrange themselves independently during the time of fertilization to give both parental and new traits in the offsprings. Correct? Yes, this is what the law states. It says that the alleles in the particular pair for a particular trait or a character, they will get segregated, separated, independent of each other during the gamete or spore formation, and they will rearrange themselves independent of each other during the time of fertilization, such that when they go in the offsprings, yes, they will give rise to either parental or completely new combination of traits. This is what we try to study in the dihybrid cross also. Yes, let's take an example of the dihybrid cross to understand this better. Yes, so we take the example of same traits, that is round and wrinkled seed along with the yellow and green color of seed. So when we know that how a dihybrid cross is done, let's not get into the complete detailed structure. Let's try doing it in a simplified manner. We have round and yellow crossed with wrinkled and green, correct? Suppose say male and female gametes. What are we expecting as a part of results? We are expecting something like this in the complete F1 generation. So all of them will be the same. Yes, we know this. Now, what happens when you carry out selfing? Yes, to get the F2 generation. How do we do it? We do it with the help of a Punnett square. Correct? Yes, how does a Punnett square work? Well, we will separate all of them. For example, say, yes, correct? Similarly, this is how a typical Punnett square works, correct? Yes, a cross between the two. This will give me gametes like this, and the zygote which is formed will have these genes, correct? Then I get, yes, first set. Next, I can get, these are probabilities, right, of getting the particular generation. Then I get followed by yes. Followed by and lastly the recessive form. Yes, we know this is obtained in the ratio of 9:3:3:1. That is, 9 will be homozygous red and yellow. Yes. Red seed, round seeds, cut, start. 9 would be homozygous for cut, sorry, start. 9 would be completely dominant. Yes, that is, it will have complete dominant capacity. Cut, sorry, start. That means 9 of them will have both the dominant traits being expressed. That is, they will be round also, yellow also. One of them will be completely recessive, that is wrinkled also and green also. Whereas, the two intermediates will have different new combinations. Yes, new traits. They will be round and green as well as wrinkled and yellow. Yes, so this would be round and yellow. Yes, this will give me, suppose say, wrinkled and say yellow. Yes, then I can have round and green, and lastly I get wrinkled and green. Correct? This is the combination that I get. So what do we understand from this? From this we understand, as we can see here, yes, these are the different probabilities. It is not that it is always these many generations that you get. Yes, all these many offsprings that you get in one generation. F2 will not have only 16 offsprings, correct? And hardcore, it is not a compulsion rule. That means you will always get them in this particular ratio. But it's not a compulsion that you will only get 16 offsprings having these amount of alleles or these kind of, you know, formation. This is not a compulsion, right? You can have n number of offsprings in that particular generation, but their ratio is always the same. Right now, we are not bothered about ratio. Right now, what we need to focus is that the difference of 6 of them, yes, 3 and 3 that you get, these 6 are completely different from the parents. These are the complete hybrids that you get. So, what are these hybrids indicating? They are indicating that the alleles have got separated, they have got distributed randomly. These are the probabilities in which it can happen. Can you say that always a dominant one will go with the other dominant? Is it so that one gene will say the other that you are a dominant one, so I'm coming with you, something like that? No, this will never happen, right? They just independently assort themselves. Yes, they just go to the gametes randomly. They get arranged randomly. They are not bothered whether the other one in my company is either a dominant one or a recessive one. Yes, that's the reason why this law is applicable to a dihybrid cross. We are taking two characters at the time. In this law, we can see that one particular trait, one particular allele for a particular trait, that is behaving independent of the other trait. It is not bothered, it is not really concerned whether the other one, the other allele is of the other trait is dominant or not, which is coming with me. No, it is not bothered about that. It is just going independent of the other one. And hence it is called law of independent assortment. It gets assorted, it gets separated independent of each other, and in the offsprings also, they express themselves in a rearranged manner. That's the reason why you always get a dihybrid ratio of 9:3:3:1, which indicates 9 and 1 are those having characters of parents, whereas the other 6, 3 and 3, are having completely new combination of traits. This is what Mendel tried to explain in his law of independent assortment, that is based on the dihybrid ratio. This was all about the laws of Mendelism. Now let's move ahead and in the next lesson meet up with a few limitations of why did Mendel's work actually fail in the beginning, and then see who were the people who studied about all the Mendelian laws and got them back and proved that these laws were all correct. Yes, let's try learning about failures and acceptance of the Mendelian laws in the next lesson. Thank you.